Thank you. conductor of the Superior Wind Symphony. You might also know me as the conductor of the Keweenaw Symphony Orchestra. This year, I am doing double duty, and it's double the pleasure because it is so fun conducting this fantastic group of tech students, none of whom are music majors. They're studying STEM fields and other stuff, so very proud of them. The theme for this concert is orchestral music, sort of. And as the orchestra guy, I thought, well, that'd be cool to do orchestra music that was all transcribed and written, sort of adapted, what you call an arrangement, for concert band. So tonight, as you listen to all of this orchestra music, I want you to tell me what is the difference between band music and orchestra music. If you've been to a lot of band concerts before, maybe you played in concert band in high school or middle school or college, and you have sort of got ingrained in your mind what is the concert band sound. And then we're playing a bunch of music that is orchestral originally, then it is arranged for a band. So I'm going to add, we're going to have a little Q&A near the end of this concert. I'm going to ask the crowd what they thought. What is the difference between band and orchestra music? So that was the great Russian Sailor's Dance, a one-hit wonder by Glier, composer of Monserva. But he wrote a real barn burner in Russian Sailor's Dance. It's got that patriotic feel to it. It had to be patriotic because he wrote it during the time of Stalin. And if it wasn't patriotic, he'd be sent to the gulag or worse. So you had to write happy Russian type pieces like that. The next piece is called Pavane by French impressionist composer Gabriel Fauré. So impressionism, if you've gone to an impressionism wing of a museum, you see the impressionist paintings like by the Monet, Claude Monet, one of the big ones. And you'll see that there's sort of this enigmatic feel, bold brush strokes, beautiful colors, a peaceful sense of nature, the transient effects of sunlight, how it plays on objects. And the composers were very interested in writing musical subjects that were inspired by impressionism and painting. So their idea of nature and enigma was using a smaller orchestra, in this case a band. And one of the favorite sort of colors in the orchestral palette for those types of French composers, 1870s, 1880s, was the woodwind section, especially the flute, and the harp. So this is one of the rare times we'll have harp with band. So this is Pavane by Fauré. Thank you. most famous British compositions is the seven-movement suite called The Planets by Gustav Holst. And probably the most famous one is the middle one, Jupiter. It's a really cool multi-movement work that we played in the Keweenaw Symphony Orchestra many years ago. It has choir, and we have imagery of the planets and the Roman gods that it was based off. A very, very fascinating piece of music. And Jupiter is certainly the most famous one. So this is an arrangement of Jupiter, the orchestral arrangement, and the band arrangement are sort of the same because Gustav Holst wrote an orchestral version and a band version, which is an arrangement of his own work. And so the planets that are described within are seven, minus Earth and Pluto. And Pluto hadn't been invented, or not invented yet. Pluto was invented a long time ago, hadn't been discovered yet. And then Pluto was discovered after the piece was written, and then Pluto was decommissioned or canceled, and now it's a dwarf planet. But nevertheless, Pluto will come later when we talk about Orpheus and the Underworld. But Jupiter, massive, biggest planet, big, impressive, right, bombastic, you name it. And so you'll hear sort of the mists of Jupiter, the bold atmosphere of Jupiter at the beginning, then big gargantuan brass, and the middle part is one of the most famous of British melodies. So enjoy Jupiter by Gustav Holst.
Thank you.
Close our first half with Orcus and the Underworld, the overture to the Opera Buffa by Jacques Offenbach, a French composer from the Romantic period. And it is basically a mockery of Napoleon III's French monarchy. He wasn't very happy with it, but it's been a great success ever since. It includes the tale of Orcus and Eurydice. And Eurydice is his wife, and Pluto, the god, he comes here. He might be a dwarf planet, but he's a god of this opera. And he comes and he steals Eurydice, or he has to go down into the hellish underworld, try to save her. But it's all sort of all messed up. It's not the right story. It's making fun of the Greek mythology, mostly making fun of Napoleon. It ends with the Can-Can, one of the most famous disobedient dances in classical music. Enjoy. Overture to Orcus in the Underworld.
Thank you.
We'll start the second half with perhaps the most famous overture of all time, with three recognizable tunes that everybody knows all across the world. It's by the Italian composer Gioacchino Rossini, who wrote Barbara Savelle and Wynne and Tell and some other great operas, maybe the most important romantic opera composer in the Italian genre, not named Verdi. And the Wienfeld Overture, it actually has a very important resonance with a TV show called The Lone Ranger theme. So you'll recognize the music. This is William Tell, overture by the Superior Wind Symphony.
Thank you.
But here in Elsa's procession to the cathedral, main female lead, her name is Elsa. And this is her falling in love with the main knight named Lohengrin, and this is her wedding day. So I believe this is like the greatest wedding music of all time. In fact, in Lohengrin, it has another great moment of wedding music that people actually do play at their weddings. But there's two great wedding tunes in this opera. It's sublime music. It's beautiful. It's gorgeous. It has these wonderful long melodies, chromaticism, dissonance, epicness, leading to a big thrilling finale, which represents the ending where everybody dies, like in all operas, right? Especially Elsa. And there's a theme at the end of every Wagner opera, which is redemption by love. That regardless of what happens in your life, you can be redeemed by sincere, chaste, beautiful love. And so there's a lot of love, a lot of emotion, and on Elsa's big wedding day. Enjoy Elsa's procession to the cathedral from Lohengrin.
Thank you.
Okay, class. Now, what is the difference between band and orchestra music? If you've been to band concerts, you've played in bands, perhaps you've played here in the pep band, listen to the pep band, hear band music, hear orchestra music. What is the difference? Let's hear it. What's the difference between band and orchestra music? There's no strings. Okay, that's a big one, right? It's usually a string bass in the back, but we don't have a string bass this semester. It is usually one string bass or one or two string. What's the difference between an orchestra and a band?
The length.
What do you mean?
Orchestra's longer.
Okay, so in terms of the length of the pieces?
Yeah.
So the answer there was that orchestra pieces are longer, right? We have fewer pieces that last longer. You have to have greater institutional memory and fortitude to get through an orchestra piece, right? Other thoughts? What are the differences between orchestra and band? We were a band playing orchestra music tonight. Thoughts? Yeah?
I feel like it has to do with the origin of the music. Like, band music was military in origin versus orchestras, like, for entertainment.
Okay, so the thoughts about origin, that bands mostly come from a military tradition and grew from there, whereas orchestra music came from a classical music, mostly European, Indo-European sort of idea, where you have music that is performed for different social functions, right? And you know, ethnic styles, right? Other thoughts? What's the difference between orchestra and band music? Yeah. Sorry?
Never mind.
Okay. Other thoughts? Okay, good folks, good. You're all getting A-plus in this class. Is there someone? Okay, fine. Go ahead.
Percussion parts are a lot less substantial.
Okay, so the percussion parts are less substantial in orchestral music. So they're super excited in the last concert, they're super excited about the next concert. This one, they're just grateful to support the main stuff, right? So the parts are much more substantial and interesting in many ways in band music. Yeah.
We're louder.
Louder. Okay.
The winds are a lot louder than the strings. Yes. A lot more strings to get the same noise as it does from the band.
Yeah, yeah, love it. Yeah. Who? What? Who? Someone else? Who? Yes.
Oh, we're just giving hints.
Okay. Now I see the quote. So saxes. So a band has saxophones, and you rarely see saxophones in a orchestral setting. It's a very important color. What other instrument is here? There's no strings, right? And in an orchestra, has everything else here, but saxes and trivia. You can't answer it, Ben. Trivia. There's an instrument that's never, ever appeared in orchestra.
Euphonium.
Euphonium and baritone. Yeah, those are some interesting things. Very good, everybody. I'll put your grade of A on bandwidth. Okay, our last piece is Hungarian Rhapsody number 2. Might not recognize the title, but it's by Franz Liszt, the handsome, dashing Hungarian pianist, the greatest pianist of the 19th century, known for being a pianist. And so this is one of his great piano pieces, and it is transcribed for band, but he arranged it for orchestra. The orchestral version was transcribed for band. This was mostly made famous by Looney Tunes, and Daffy Duck, and Bugs Bunny, and Tom and Jerry, and so forth. So you will enjoy it a lot. Thanks so much for coming tonight. I appreciate the Rosé crew, Denny, and all the wonderful students on the tech side. Very appreciative of them, and thank you for being here tonight. I conduct another concert next week, next Saturday, Kimono Symphony Orchestra. We're doing Enigma variations.